what all I had. So students, we had started with the reading of the chapter Summer of the Beautiful White Horse. This is the first chapter of your second book, that is Snapshots, right? And what are the things that we had discussed yesterday? Who are the characters? We have Aram and Murad. So this, yeah, they are cousins. Murad is the elder one. He is quite passionate about animals and horses. And it seems that he has a little bit of craziness in his behavior, right? Then which tribe they belong to? The Garo-Galanian tribe. Please remember the spelling. I might ask you a question and identify the correct spelling. Let me see your presence of mind, which we are not doing nowadays. So important here to see how much you're actually paying attention to what you are doing, okay? They belong to the Garo-Galanian tribe. And what was the Garo-Galanian tribe known for? It was known for honesty and trust, right? For their integrity, that is, they could never lie or cheat, right? And they could never ever do something wrong, right? And here it was there, they have, their lives have changed. They are now not in a very prosperous condition. But in spite of that, they have not given up their principles or the values that their tribe stood for, which is something very, very remarkable. Sometimes our needs and necessity, they make us compromise with our ideals. And so it is very, very difficult, you know, and I would say it is very, very praiseworthy also that in difficult situations, you stick to the values that you really stand for, right? So they belong to the Garo-Galanian tribe. What have they done? They've gone horse riding. Why is it surprising? Because they are too poor to own a horse. So what is the logical explanation? Where did that horse come from? They stole it. But Garo-Galanians don't steal. So it's a vicious circle. What is the possible explanation? Right? Yes, Imasho? Yes. Okay. And of course, we also talk about, who do we talk about? We talk about Uncle. Why do we talk about Uncle Khosrow? What has he done? Uncle Khosrow was the owner of the horse. Absolutely wrong, right? It was John Byro who was the owner of the horse. Uncle Khosrow was there. He had this craziness and it seemed as if Murad has inherited that craziness. And Uncle Khosrow was deeply affected by all the problems that have happened to the people of his community, to the people of his tribe. It seems as if he's not come out of that shock, right? Yes, and so let's continue reading this chapter. All of you look at the screen and those here in the class, look at your books, please. One day back there in the good old days, when I was 9 and the world was full of every imaginable kind of magnificence. What a beautiful age it is. Innocence. A 9-year-old, you don't bother about the world. You don't even realize there are problems in the world, isn't it? Yes. And the world was full of every imaginable kind of magnificence and life was still a delightful and mysterious dream. My cousin Murad, who was considered crazy by everybody who knew him except me, came to my house at 4 in the morning, woke me up, tapping on the window of my room. So he was 9 years old when this experience is talking about. Very innocent child, not aware of the problems of the world. Most beautiful age, right? And his cousin came knocking on his window. Aram, he said, I jumped out of bed and looked out of the window. I couldn't believe what I saw. It wasn't morning yet, 4 o'clock. Yes, it's still not daybreak, not light. But it was summer. And with daybreak, not many minutes around the corner of the world, soon going to be day. It was light enough for me to know I was not dreaming. So 4 o'clock, some of you have just started falling asleep, considering the nightlife that you people have, isn't it? Right? And yes, you're deep in your dreams and very deep slumber. It's difficult to get up at 4 o'clock. Yes? No? So yeah, we do. And sometimes we feel that we're still in a dream, waking up so early. So here, Aram, yes, but it was quite clear and he knew he was not dreaming what he saw outside. What did he see? My cousin Murad was sitting on a beautiful white horse. I stuck my head out of the window and rubbed my eyes. He couldn't believe himself, waking him up. Am I sleeping? Am I dreaming? Yes, he said in Armenian, it's a horse. You're not dreaming. Make it quick if you want to ride. He says, hurry up if you want to ride. Otherwise, I'm leaving without you. I knew my cousin Murad enjoyed being alive more than anybody else who had ever fallen into the world by mistake. But this was more than even I could believe. I knew he loved, every moment of life. He was so lively, and very few people are like that. Otherwise, there are people who just keep on complaining and grumbling the whole day, and you feel, oh my God, life is such a mess, isn't it? So we like people who spread that positivity. We like people who have a lot of energy, and Murad was one of them. But he says that even I could not believe that he's riding a horse at this time of the day. In the first place, my earliest memories had been memories of horses. And my first longings had been longings to ride. So as he was growing up, yeah, he dreamt of horses. He wanted to ride a horse. He had this deep desire. This was the wonderful part. Now comes the wonderful part. In the second place, we were poor. Couldn't afford a horse. Right? So where did Murad get this horse from? This was the part that would not permit me to believe that what I saw. We were poor. We had no money. Our whole tribe was poverty stricken. Every branch of the Garoglanian family was living in the most amazing and comical poverty in the world. Why comical? What is comical? Funny, yeah. So is there anything funny about being poor? So it is that they have, accepted their circumstances, not doing much to change it, right? And yes, they're happy now there. Right, so they're not grumbling and complaining, although they have undergone a lot of, change in their lives. Nobody could understand where we ever got money enough to keep us with food in our bellies, not even the old men of the family, but it just happened, somehow they kept on working, somehow they kept themselves alive, and they got food in their bellies. We had been famous for our honesty for something like 11 centuries. Old, reputed tribe with a very long, reputed tradition, right, or values. We were most important of all, though we were famous for our honesty. We had been famous for our honesty for something like 11 centuries. Even when we had been the wealthiest family in what we like to think was the world, they thought the place where they lived, that is the world. And there they were the wealthiest. Okay. Where is Armenia? You will find out and tell me. Yes. So we were proud first, honest next. And after that, we believed in right and wrong. So this was their order in which they believed. They were proud, self-respecting. Then they believed, yes, we were honest. And then, of course, what is right and what is wrong. None of us would take advantage of anybody in the world, let alone steal. So this is why he cannot believe that Murad is there sitting on a horse right in front of him. Even if they were poverty-stricken, they had never gone against their values. Consequently, even though I could see the horse, so magnificent, even though I could smell it, so lovely, even though I could hear it breathing, so exciting, I couldn't believe the horse had anything to do with my cousin Murad or with me or with any of the other members of our family asleep or awake, because I knew my cousin Murad could not have bought the horse, and if he couldn't have bought the horse, he must have stolen it. And I refused to believe he had stolen it. So it is that because of the principles, because of the values, it's very difficult to believe, right? And they have how many centuries of this reputation? 11 centuries, right? No member of the Garoglanian family could be a thief. I stared first at my cousin and then at the horse. There was a pious stillness and humor in each of them, which on the one hand delighted me and on the other frightened him. He's happy, right? I'll get to ride a horse. But he's scared also. Where did the horse come from? So he's there that moment, you know, he has to decide. And I think that moment, it happens in everyone's life. There is a moment where you have to decide between right and wrong, right? And a wrong step can change your life forever, right? So he is there at that moment. I stared at first at my cousin and then at the horse. There was a, okay, we've read this. Murad, I said, where did you steal this horse? Leap out of the window, he said, if you want to ride. So he's not answering his question. He said, just come out of the window. It was true then. He had stolen the horse. There was no question about it. He had come to invite me to ride or not as I chose. He's telling me that, see, I have the horse, you want to ride it, it's your choice. I've asked you. Well, it seemed to me stealing a horse for a ride was not the same thing as stealing something else, such as money. Why is it different? Why you steal money, it's a crime, but you steal a horse for riding, it's not. Yes? Money has been used and the horse, it doesn't get exhausted, poor thing. Khana bhi nahi khilaya usko. Oh my God, how sad. Yes? Okay, so we are clear. We're not a thief. You are there. Like, of course, your friend is there, has a very nice expensive pen and she really is very fond of it. She does a work with that. You've seen her doing that project also with it, right? But what do? One day, because you also like the pen, you take the pen without her permission. And the next day she comes to school. She's so upset. She can't find it. And she's telling that I've lost my pen, right? And after doing your work and after you feel, okay, this pen is not working, then one day after 2-3 days, you come back and keep it back. Is it right or is it wrong? So money, when money is involved, then it's a crime. Is it? So when money is involved and things are wrong, but if you take something and you return it, it is nothing happens at all. Yeah, money is over, finished. So you have to go to jail for it. You have to be punished for it. Is it? So don't bring your economy or whatever here in this. Let's talk about the moral impact of it. So why are these measured on a different scale? Why are we here telling that let us give the child another chance? Because maybe like he did that out of innocence and wanted a pen like that. He cannot afford that. Did not tell his friend because his friend would never have given him that pen. Right? But see, he's returned it. How honest. But when it comes to money, it's wrong. Wo bhi return karoge, to bhi tumhara, you've not committed a crime. Is it? So once again here, as we grow up, we have different parameters to judge ourselves, isn't it? Right? Yes. So we are there. We decide ourselves only. Right? Like things you take as your own. Okay. Like mommy, yeah, she's expecting guests tomorrow and she's bought so many things. Okay. So there are sweets and cakes and ice creams and all. And you felt like having one or two pastries, jate jate you finished it. And when she saw in the evening, there's only one left. But there's nothing wrong. Khane ki cheez, I had it. Why should I feel guilty about it? I didn't do anything wrong. Isn't it? So our parameters change. Ye to ghar ki baat hai. Why would mommy get angry? I can go and buy something more. Isn't it? Right? But the thing is, yes, we need to realize, we need to ask permission. We need to tell. Right. So, and of course, nobody is ever going to say no. That is what we take for granted. So we have to decide little things in life. They teach us great values. So sometimes a childhood adventure, for you, it might be an adventure. You might not realize the moral value of it. You might not realize what could be the consequences of that. But if you keep on doing things like this, your friend has taken the pen once. Next time you take a book, right? Next time you go away with your phone also, right? Yeah, with your bag, it might kidnap you also. So don't worry, then what? Fine? So it is that we have to take these things into account. These things need to be talked about. These things, they need to be discussed. And of course, parameters for a child. Yes, why we give them so much of advantage that the child is still learning. Maybe he's not mature enough to realize the consequences of his actions. So this is why he's saying it is not as the same as stealing money. For all I knew, maybe it wasn't stealing at all. You take a horse for riding and you keep it back, it's not stealing. Do you think he's justifying his action by giving all these? Yes, he is. He's justifying himself. He's justifying, okay, I'm not doing anything wrong, right? Yeah, I used it and I had the ride and I've kept it back, right? I took my friend's bike for a ride and so what? I finished the petrol and both he might have to drag it home and I've kept it back. It's his bike, take it now. I don't need it anymore. Fine. So we have our own explanations. We justify our actions, isn't it? Right? So this is what we have to decide about. What is right and what is wrong? If you were crazy about horses, the way my cousin Murad and I were, but if you were crazy about horses, you would never ever think of it as a crime, right? So of course, so sometimes your passion for that, your craze for that, it wasn't stealing. Now listen to the next line. It wouldn't become stealing until we offer to sell the horse. It's not a crime at all. We're not selling the horse. I'm going to keep it back. So no, there's nothing wrong in it. I took my friend's bike for a ride. I gave it back. I didn't sell it. Right? Fine. No. So what? He was in such a big problem the whole day. He was looking there for his bike. He got a scolding from his parents. He might have to go and register a complaint. And at the end of the day, he saw that, wow, his bike turned up magically outside his gate. Right? So fine, what about that mental problems that you caused, right? Fine, yes, which of course I knew we would never do. So he's very sure and he's never going to steal that horse. So he's never going to sell it. Let me put on some clothes. I said, all right, he said, but hurry. I leaped into my clothes. I jumped down to the yard from the window and leaped up onto the horse behind my cousin Murad. That year, we lived at the edge of town on Walnut Avenue. Behind our house was the country, vineyards, orchards, irrigation ditches, and country roads. In less than 3 minutes, we were on Olive Avenue. And then the horse began to trot. The air was new and lovely to breathe. The feel of the horse running was wonderful. My cousin Murad was considered one of the craziest members of her family, began to sing. So happy he was. I mean, he began to roar, singing so loudly. He was so happy. Every family has a crazy streak in it somewhere. We agree. Yes, there's always that crazy cousin that you have, and you really look up to that cousin, isn't it? And my cousin Murad was considered the natural descendant of the crazy streak in our tribe. Before him was our uncle Khosrow, an enormous man with a powerful head of black hair and the largest mustache in the San Joaquin Valley. A man so furious in temper, so irritable, so impatient that he stopped anyone from talking by roaring. So you talk to him and he would just simply roar. It is no harm, pay no attention to it. This was his favorite response. So he was there, the person who had that craziness. Who inherited that craziness? Murad, right? Considering the way he was there, crazy about horses, the way he's riding it, and the way he's singing so loudly. That was all. No matter what anybody happened to be talking about, you could talk about anything, you could talk about your biggest problem in life. And what is Uncle Khosrow going to say? It is no harm. Pay no attention to it. Once it was his own son, Eric, running 8 blocks to the barber's shop where his father was having his mustache trimmed to tell him the house was on fire. So his son coming and telling him. This man, Khosrow, sat up in the chair and roared. It is no harm. Pay no attention to it. The barber said, but the boy says your house is on fire. So, Khosrow, enough. It is no harm, I say. So when his house burning is also not getting a response from him. He's not going to react and his only response is, it's no harm. My cousin Murad was considered the natural descendant of this man. Although Murad's father was Zorab, who was practical and nothing else. His father was there, his qualities different. That's how it was in our tribe. A man could be the father of his son's flesh, but that did not mean that he was also the father of his spirit. What does spirit mean over here? What do you think spirit means over here? Behavior? Yes. So, right. So when we see here, Murad there, his father was very practical, very responsible, but Murad is there crazy. Uncle Khosrow, very crazy, very, you can say, least concerned about what is happening in his life. And his son there, quite sensible. So it could be different here. So he says, this is how it happens in our tribe. It's not necessary that the father and son, they have to be same in their behavior. Okay? Right. But that did not mean that he was also the father of his spirit. The distribution of the various kinds of spirit of our tribe had been from the beginning capricious and vagrant. So they were very, very, you could predict who was going to be like what. Can predict the behavior. Just because the father is very calm and composed does not mean that the son is also going to be like that. Okay, so very wide and unpredictable distribution. We rode and my cousin Murad sang. For all anybody knew, we were still in an old country where, at least according to some of our neighbors, we belonged. We let the horse run as long as it felt like running. At last, my cousin Murad said, "Get down, I want to ride alone." "Will you let me ride alone?" I asked. "That is up to the horse," my cousin said. "Get down." "The horse will let me ride," I said. "We shall see," he said. "Don't forget that I have a way with a horse. I'm very good with animals. I can control the horses. I don't know about you." "Well," I said, "anyway, you have with a horse, I have also. If you can control the horse, so can I." "For the sake of you, your safety," he said, "let us hope. Get down." "All right," I said, "but remember, you've got to let me try to ride alone." So he's also, otherwise he's going to blackmail him. "I'll go and tell the family what you're doing." I got down and my cousin Murad kicked his heels into the horse and shouted, "Wazir, run." The horse stood on its hind legs, snorted and burst into a fury of speed that was the loveliest thing I had ever seen. My cousin Murad raced the horse across the field of dry grass to an irrigation ditch, crossed the ditch on the horse, and minutes later returned dripping wet. Irrigation ditch, the water was flowing to water the fields there. The sun was coming up. "Now it's my turn to ride," I said. My cousin Murad got off the horse. "Ride," he said. I leapt to the back of the horse and for a moment knew the most awful fear imaginable. The horse did not move. Poor thing. "Kick into his muscles," my cousin Murad said. "What are you waiting for? We've got to take him back before everybody in the world is up and about. So it's getting daylight. People will be coming out. They'll see the horse. So hurry up if you want to ride." "But what has happened to the horse? It's not moving. It's not ready to run." I kicked into the muscles of the horse. Once again, it reared and snorted. Then it began to run. I didn't know what to do. Instead of running across the field to the irrigation ditch, the horse ran down to the vineyard of Dikran Halabian, where it began to leap over vines. The horse leaped over 7 vines before I fell. Then it continued running. Poor thing. What? So the horse there, very, what you can say, aggressive, full of energy, threw the boy down and kept on running. Okay. And yes, so Adam was not able to control the horse. My cousin Murad came down running down the road. "I'm not worried about you," he shouted. "We've got to get that horse. You'll be fine. Don't worry. We've got to get that horse. You go this way and I'll go this way. if you come upon him, be kindly, I'll be near. Be kind with the horse. Don't make the horse run even more further away. Okay. So with this, I think so. We have time or not? Okay. So we'll put an end to it.